like to multiply, if I want to solve problems, I want to multiply. So imagine I've got two n-digit numbers here, and I want to calculate how many multiplications I do when I'm multiplying. So this times this, this is what I learned in elementary school, it's this guy times all of these, and then it's this guy. Elementary school, the algorithm you learned for multiplication was big theta of n squared. Okay, then it's people wanted to develop faster algorithms. 1 month ago, the best algorithm was theta log n times log log n. And then, this is still.
What's that word say?
A best, oh, 1 month ago? So 1 month ago, the best algorithm was theta of n times log n times log log n. And so, do you have a feel? Is this better or worse than n squared? It's better, yeah. Actually, much better. Okay, but now, somebody just worked on this. So, if you saw the headline, it's the previous best known algorithm was theta of n log n log log n. And now the best algorithm is theta of n log n. You know exactly what they're talking about. Thanks for this class.
Didn't get the coverage it deserved. Right?
In the right circles it did.
That's
right.
It's like
mixed.
Yeah, so it's, I'm guessing this is theoretically the best possible bound you can get.
It's not known but suspected that it's the best possible bound. No one's been able to prove that.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Good enough. So that is still an open question. Is this the best you can do? It feels like the best you can do.
For multiple.
It's at least n, right?
Yeah.
You have to at least look at every digit. And one more thing I want to tell you about. We're going to skip. The binomial coefficient identity, so 6-2, and we're going to skip the rest of inclusion-exclusion. So, they're interesting. 8.6. Remember at the beginning of the semester, we talked about binary numbers, how to represent a number in binary, how to do addition and multiplication. We talked about sets, because we needed those for later in the course. So same thing is, we're going to need a little bit of linear algebra for the third part of the course. And I can't really make a story out of it. So this is just some infrastructure we're going to need for some concepts that come up a little bit later. If you've had linear algebra before, most of this is going to be familiar, and some of it is going to be new. Even better. So I forgot to print out my notes, but I can look over your shoulder. Perfect. Okay, so, good. Okay. Some words, some operations. So, a matrix is a rectangular grid numbers. The plural of matrix is matrices. Okay, so like what variables do we use for functions? F, G, H. What variables do we use for propositions? P, U, R. So the idea is different letters we use to stand for different things. So we tend to use capital A, B, and C as variables for matrices. So I could say something like this. It is big A, that's going to be a variable that stands for a matrix. A matrix is just a rectangular grid of numbers. And so sometimes you look at the numbers individually, sometimes kind of group them together. So I could look at these two numbers together. When I'm grouping them horizontally like this, we call those rows. So row one is these two together, row two is the middle two, row three is the last two. All my other colors ran out, so new greens. So sometimes we'll want to group the numbers vertically, and when I group it vertically, I call it a column. I want to talk about the shape of this rectangle. So it's a rectangular grid of numbers. It's the shape of it is described by how many rows and three columns. So we say A has three rows and two columns. Say that A is a 3x2 matrix. We talk about the dimensions of a matrix. First number is number of rows. Second number is number of columns. And there's various things that we can do with matrices. Two matrices together. So the number that goes here, so I'm going to combine those two. So what number do you think I put there?
Six.
Exactly right. Green rectangle. Everybody agree with 8? What do you think goes here?
10.
And
12.
Okay. So if I have two matrices that are the same shape, a 2x2 plus a 2x2 matrix, I can add them together to make a new 2x2. You have them in your algebra. This is straightforward. Same as before. What am I going to do next?
Subtraction.
That's actually a good guess. I'm in the multiplication, but you're right. Logical choice. Okay, this is a stranger operation, so it's not what you said. It's not going to be 5, 12, 21, 32. I think it should be, but it's not. Let me show you the process for multiplication. What I do is I write the first matrix here, the second matrix up here, and then I'm going to use these to generate the entries. So to generate this entry, I take the first row of this matrix, the first column here. Is I do 1 times 5 plus 2 times 7, 5 and 14 is 19. at this entry, I take the row of the matrix over here, the column of that second matrix, and then I do this trick. So multiply the components and add them together. 1 times 5 plus 2 times 14. Professor?
Yes.
Do this one for me. So there's going to be a number that goes here. I'm going to use these two and those two. So I got 1 times 6 plus 2 times 8. I got 6 plus 16. 22. Right? So just to make sure we're on the same page, 15 and 28 is 43. 18 and 32. You can double check those. You should work out. I'll show you one more thing. So one thing I forgot to put in the notes. I should be still forward. A is that 2x2 matrix. What do you think A squared is going to be? Is multiplied by itself.
Yes.
Fill in the rest. You should do this at home and verify we're on the same page. So if I ask for a squared, the answer is 7, 10, 15, 20. And later on we're going to talk about why we care about this, because I just want to get the infrastructure, get the basic calculations down. Another thing we do to a matrix is we do call it taking the transpose. The symbol for that is A with an uppercase T. And what I do is I read off the column and write it as a row. So what's the first column of A?
1, 3, 5.
So what's the first row of A transpose?
1, 3, 5.
Right. What's the second row of A transpose?
2, 4, 6.
At some point, I'm going to say take the transpose of a matrix and you're going to know what I mean. So that's all linear algebra stuff. So a 0-1 matrix is exactly what you'd expect it to be. It's a matrix with only zeros and ones. zero, one matrices. You know, the idea is you think about the plus as an or. Exactly, so the 0, 1 entries are trues and falses. And just like I do over the way I do a sum is I add the appropriate components together. So to get this entry, I do these two, but I do it with an or. So what's 1 or 0, true or false?
True.
And the true. Entry here. What's 1 or 1? True or true is true. So that would be a 1. If it was regular addition, it would have been a 2. If we're doing Boolean addition, it's a 1.
Does the plus always get circled?
Yes. Yeah, so we circle the plus to distinguish it between regular addition.
So plus is not like so. It sort of has the
same. Yeah, I know. There's no good. I do not know. Perhaps not. And then just like we do Boolean addition, we do Boolean multiplication. What's that?
Did you say?
Not quite. It's gonna be, remember how regular multiplication we did sum of products, we multiplied and added?
Mm-hmm.
So the idea is the multiplications are gonna be ands and the additions are gonna be ors. The best way to think about it is when we do a Boolean multiplication, only applies to 0, 1 matrices. We're going to do the regular multiplication, except instead of where we do addition, we're going to do an or. Where we do multiplication, we're going to do an and. I got more homework questions than usual in office hours today, so I'm guessing that due date's coming up pretty soon.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so happy to hear you did not put that off. So I bet I've got. We're going to use that circle for Boolean multiplication. The idea here. Let's write the first matrix like this. Yeah, you have to be careful. Let me show you the trick. Is what are the dimensions of this matrix?
3 by 3.
Close.
3 by 3.
3 by 2.
3 by 2.
3 by 2.
So row them. How many is this?
2 by 2.
So you're only allowed to multiply if these two numbers match up. And And the answer is going to be a 3 by 3. It's, you can't multiply any two matrices together. They've got to have the right shape. So remember, it's we're using the electrical engineers pluses and times, which we did at the beginning of the semester. So in this context, 1 is true, 0 is false, times is and, plus is or. So what's true and true?
True.
True. False and false?
False.
True or false?
True. True.
Entry. So work this one out. Make sure you know what it is. So I do 1 and 0 plus 0 and 1. Good. So true and false is false. True and false is false. False and true is false. False or false is false. So that's the idea. Yeah, thanks for bringing me up today. Last thing we want to talk about. So what do you think that this is going to be? And what type of multiplication? Exactly. I'm not going to compute all of these. There's going to be 4 possible. There's going to be 4 numbers to get. Let's do this one.
True.
True. So 1 times 1 plus 1 times 1. What's 1 times 1? 1 times 1 is 1. What's 1 plus 1? You got it. So again, that's the linear algebra that we're going to need for the rest of the course. Okay, Derek Smith, Mathemagical Packet of Wonder. Get it out. And who didn't bring theirs? Chapter 9 intro. It's going to start with some BART stations. Starts at the BART stations. Okay. So I want you to imagine that you are. those of you using the 6th, or I guess the 7th and 8th edition, we're at the start of chapter 10. 6th edition is start of chapter 9. So Bart has hired you to calculate, to help people get around the BART system. So you're going to write a program where the input is your starting and your ending BART station. And then they're going to tell you which trains to get on. Well, basically, so you're going to get a route, because they're going to list out every station you're going to pass through. And we've got right here a subset of BART. So we're going to talk about how to represent this. So the BART stations are, you've got like merit, you've got fruit fail, we've got West Oakland in there somewhere. Are these accurate placements?
12th Street is north of Lake Mack.
Exactly.
And 19th Street is north of that.
Okay, so the point I want to make with these is we don't care about where they are relative to each other or how far away. It's we just want to get a mathematical model of the connection between them. So here are different stations, and again, not laid out according to geography, but you can show what's connected to what. What's Lake Merritt connected to? So it's connected to Fruit Valley, so I'm going to draw a line between those two. And Lake Merritt is connected to 12th Street.
And West Oakland.
And West Oakland. What's Fruit Valley connected to? Oh, I forgot one. Red Coliseum, right? And is that on my chart, Coliseum?
Not here.
Does it mention it?
Yeah,
connected
it
to Fruitvale? Yeah. So Fruitvale is connected to the Coliseum. What else is Fruitvale connected to?
Lake Merritt.
Right. 12th Street? I think just Fruitvale is connected to two stations. 12th Street is connected to 19th Street.
Yeah.
It's connected to West Oakland. To Lake Merritt, we got it already. And then finally, West Oakland is connected to Barcadero. Got that? How did I get that?
Your West Oakland to 12th Street line is also your Barcadero.
Oh, yeah, that was a problem. There's Barcadero. So West Oakland goes to Barcadero like that? So, do you believe that this is a schematic showing the relationships that are listed here? Somewhat. So, each dot represents a station. If one station is connected to each other, we've got a green line connecting them. More vocabulary. Structure. Let's call it graph. So graph is a precise math term. It's just different than the other graphs that you learned in earlier classes. So graph is just a collection of dots, and some of the dots are connected to the other dots. Is called a vertex. And the plural of vertex is what?
Vertices.
So a graph has a bunch of vertices. There are a bunch of dots. And lines connect. vertices are going to be web pages. So we've got the web page 1.com, 2.com. Where should I draw 3.com? Should it be bottom left, bottom right, over here? Exactly, the point is it doesn't matter. All we care about is the connections between the sites, not where we where they're laid out. So 3.com. Here are, I'm going to make a graph with four vertices, those web pages. And then I'm going to draw an edge if one page links to another page. So what does 1.com link to?
2, 3.
Does 2 link back to 1? So on this one, well, back here, if we can go from, if Lake Merritt's connected to Fruitvale, Fruitvale has to be connected to Lake Merritt, which is different than if 1 links to 2, 2 links to 1. So what we do here is we put arrows on these to indicate which way the edges go. And then what does 2 link to? Yeah, let's talk about that. So I'm going to table that for a moment. And then, yeah.
Wait, why are you not able to go back?
Oh, no. This is clicking a link.
Oh, okay. So if you go back, then...
So my web page links to the New York Times.
Right.
But New York Times is not linked back to my web page. They should.
Yeah.
3 just goes to 1. And then 4 goes to... How many edges are in this graph? Bless you. How many edges are in this graph? Got 1.
8.
8? We can't count that high. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Very good. 8. So sometimes, as an abbreviation, as Mark pointed out, is notice that 1.com and 4.com each link to each other. So you could represent it by a double arrow. How many edges in this graph? It's still 2. So this is a shorthand or an abbreviation for these 2 edges. So be careful. You might just be tempted to count how many lines you see, but if it's a double arrow, it really counts as 2. Then the last thing I want you to do is to look at the flights that we have here. So now, the vertices of the graph, oh, actually, before we do that, okay, so Larry Page and Sergey Brin. Brinnerman. Okay, so they're Stanford math PhD students. And I said, you know what? You can think of the internet as a graph, which no one has really done before. And then, as you're going to see later today, is you can translate a graph into a matrix, which is why we talked about it. And once we have a matrix, you can use all the tools of linear algebra. So they somehow use this graph to make a matrix, and then use some linear algebra to calculate actually what's called the $7 billion eigenvector. So they calculate an eigenvector for that graph, and that's what they use to build their first search engine. Exact topics that they started this multi-billion-dollar. So, another website, or another thing I might want to do is I'm trying to get from Oakland to New York to JFK Airport, and I want to do it as cheaply as possible. So, I've got some information about flights. So, I'm going to use a graph to represent this. The airports I have. Oakland, LAX, missing anything here?
No.
So I've got Oakland to LAX. Should I use an arrow or no? And the information I have is that the Oakland to LAX costs $60. So not only do I want to indicate there is a connection between those two, but I want to decorate that edge with a number. So on this graph, we've got a connection from Oakland to LAX, and with this edge, we associate the $60. I'm going to give you a starting vertex, a destination vertex, and have you come up with the cheapest possible path from the start to the end. So it's easy to do in your head when it's small like this, but I'm going to show you an algorithm that will work when you have all the U.S. cities and all the flights in between. Yeah?
I just noticed that last graph has a source and a sink. Is there a particular reason?
It's just, how can I say it? That's a good point. It's just needed as an example. Some more. Let me show you some vocabulary words. Notice sometimes we want our edges to have direction, sometimes we don't. So the words we use are directed versus. Taking class in algorithms, data structures and algorithms class. In the first sentence, or the start of the first sentence in the textbook you're reading, let G be a directed graph. So what does that say to you? Good. Yeah, first of all, it's going to be a graph. It's going to be a collection of vertices with some edges, and the edges are going to have arrows indicating the direction. And then they might talk more about that. And the cool kids, I'd like to say all these syllables. What the cool kids call a directed graph a digraph. I see various theorems on digraphs, that's what it means.
So each edge of a directed graph is basically two edges.
It could be. So you can model an undirected graph with a directed graph. You just have twice as many edges. And then, another distinction. You could imagine that we decorate a grand edge, maybe with a dollar amount, maybe with a distance, maybe with a time. And that could be either with a directed or an undirected. More vocabulary. So if we're associating a number with each end, which we call it a weighted graph. And if there's no number associated with the edge, we call it an unweighted graph. So if I talk about a weighted, undirected graph, do you have a mental picture of that? Weighted undirected graphs on the board. So how would you? So it, what if I added the time it took to go between each stage? Then that would be a weighted undirected. More vocabulary. How many edges do we have coming into West Oakland? Three. We've got a word for that. We say the degree is three. The degree of a vertex is how many edges are associated with that vertex. So what's the degree of this one? Three here. That is a good question. So we actually have two notions. For a directed graph, we've got in degrees and out degrees. So what's the in degree for two?
What comes in from one?
There's one that goes in. What's the out degree? Good. For three, the in degree is? So there's three in?
One.
And the out degree. So if it's a directed graph, as we talk about degree, we split it up between the in degree. I'll tell you one more idea. Let's try to draw this. I'm going to be 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I'm going to tell you I've got enough symmetry. Connected to 2 and 4. 2 is connected to 1 and 3. 3 is connected to 2 and 4. And 4 is connected to 1 and 3. two and four.
Four to make it one.
Does this also model this graph?
It has some configuration.
No, actually, so because one's connected to two and two's connected to one, it's legal in both ways, so we don't need it. So you see these look different when I write them on the board?
Yes.
But yet it really represents the same graph. Okay, so what I want you to imagine is we've got this situation. It's, in my mind, I see a graph. And I label everything like this. In your mind, so this is the picture I have. I'm labeling the graphs 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And this is the graph you have. You label your graphs, you label your vertices A, B, C, and D. Are we thinking of the same graph?
Yes.
Okay, so these are, in some sense, are you sure? It's, I used numbers for my vertices. You use letters.
Mm-hmm.
I drew mine over on the left here. You drew yours on the right. So at some deep structural level, they're the same. So we've got a word for them. Another math word. So isomorphic is the math way of saying that at some deep level, they have the same structure. And then the isomorphism is the translation between the two. So I'm going to say things about my graph, and I want you to be able to translate them into things about your graph. So what's the translation? Yes. So one, when I talk about one, you're talking about C. When I talk about two, that's B. Three is?
Two is D.
Two is actually.
Two is D. Three is
B.
Four is
E.
Five is
D.
So.
Depends on when you rotate it, right?
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah, this isn't the only translation. So there's more than one translation. Okay. So I can say, vertex 4 has degree equal to 1. So in my graph, when I'm looking at vertex 4, what's the degree?
1.
Okay, and then if we make the translation, 4 corresponds to what? Is that true for you, that vertex E has degree 1? Okay. So I can make any graph statement about my picture here. And if I make a true statement about this graph and use this translation, it should be a true statement about your graph. Okay. Are these isomorphic? Yeah, can you give me a statement that's true about this that's not true about that?
3 and 1 are connected.
Okay, so all points in the graph are
degree 2.
Good, yeah, we're all good. 1 is connected to 3. And actually,
all points have 2 degrees.
Good.
That
so
one, this one.
Every vertex has
2 degrees
equals to 2. So that's a true statement about my graph, and that's not true about your graph. So either there's a way to translate statements between graphs, in which case they're isomorphic. Or there's going to be some statement that's true about one that's not true about the other. And it can't be I wrote one in black and one in green, or I used numbers for some vertices and letters for other. It's got to be a graph statement. So. I'm going to give you two pairs of graphs. And you are going to determine whether they're isomorphic or not. This, either there's a way to translate between 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and A, B, C, D, E, and F. So any statement I make here is also true about that one and vice versa. Or there's something that's true about one of these graphs, false about the other.
Do they have a left wall?
Yeah, it's, I'm going to go refresh the pen supply. Yeah, so both of them, yeah, it's a rectangle in a rectangle, and I'm just hooking up these guys differently. Okay, so don't say anything yet, because I'm going to go enjoy my break. So I'm sure somebody posted something wrong on Reddit, and we're going to go one of the graphs and not true about the other. Here is a statement about graphs where this is true, that's false. What do you think about this one? Are they isomorphic?
No.
Okay, the answer is no, and it's easier to convince me of a no. So tell me some statement here that's true here and false here, or vice versa.
Vice versa.
Okay, sounds good. Something's true here.
So, vertice E is connected to two vertices that have degree 3.
So, E is connected to two degree 3 vertices. Is there something here? Oh, 5 is connected to 2 degree 3 vertices.
6.
E is itself.
Good. E, which has degree 3, is connected to 2 degree 3 vertices. So there's a statement that's true about this graph, that's false about this one. So however you do the translation, you're never going to be able to, you're never going to make the translation where we always agree.
What does it mean for E to have 2 degree 3 vertices?
Oh, is connected to. So here's E. And notice that E is connected to A, which has degree 3. And E is connected to H, which also has degree 3.
And then, wouldn't that mean that would be the same? Or?
So find a degree 3 vertex here that's connected to two other degree.
Okay.
Right. So again, that's how you play the game. is either there's a translation between the two, and any true statement in one is a true statement in the other, or there's some statement that distinguishes them.
So, that one, I didn't want to say you know what it's right. I said all vertices have a degree that is bigger or equal to 2.
Perfect. So a statement, all vertices have degree 2 or more, is true here. Is that true here? It's not? So these are not isomorphic, because there's something that's true for this, false for that. You got it. So how hard, is it possible? Imagine you want to write an algorithm that'll decide whether two graphs are isomorphic or not. So one way to do it is just to look at every possible translation. So I could say maybe 1 goes to A, 2 goes to B, goes to C, or actually maybe 3 goes to F. Maybe this is my translation. And then on this side, I say 3 is connected to 2 and 4. Is F connected to B? Yeah, is F connected to B? So this would be a bad choice. So what you're going to do is just look at every possible translation and see if they worked out. So how many different ways are there to make a translation? So I pick where it goes for 1. How many choices do I have for what 1 could be? And then, 2, how many choices? And then?
6.
Right. So how many possible translation tables are there? 8 factorial. So if you don't think too hard about it, you just try every possibility. The graph isomorph, we'd say the graph isomorphism problem is big theta of n factorial. And we do, we know, but it's big O of n factorial. That's an upper bound.
So what you're saying is there's 8 factorial of graphs that are equivalent to this.
No.
Okay.
What I'm saying with given these two graphs, there's 8 factorial ways to make a translation between the two graphs.
I'm not sure about that.
So you see I could extend this entire table out. Or maybe I'm going to do 1 goes to C, and 2 goes to B, and 3 goes to 8. Is this is another table of translations I can make.
Wait, so are we not trying to make graphs that are isomorphic?
Oh, okay. So what I want you to do is imagine that you're trying to come up with a general algorithm where the input will be 2 graphs,
and
the output will be isomorphic or not.
Okay.
Can you do n factorial?
Can you do better than n factorial?
Well, that's a good question. So yeah, everyone, that's an open problem, is how simple can you make this? And yes, you can do better than n factorial. Because so you can immediately eliminate some choices for 1. Right? Would you do 1 corresponding to A? No. And you know immediately that you wouldn't need to finish any of those. So yeah, people have been clever. And it was about 2 years ago, somebody got a fairly big breakthrough. They got a much smaller bound. It's still an open question, so people still work on that.
So like, if one edge isn't like responding, don't connect the other edges.
Exactly.
Still
so I don't really have 8 choices for 1, right?
Going back to like the airplane problem, the cost that you were talking about. So if it's like, if it's one of those speed, do they go through the same process of like finding the price as what you were talking about?
No, is what we're doing here is we're trying to see if 2 graphs are the same.
Okay.
They already have 1 graph that they're working with, and they're just doing things with that graph. Yeah.
Next question. So you're comparing the 2 graphs.
Right.
So will one graph go through n factorial and the other one go through n factorial?
No, no.
Okay.
Yeah. So imagine I'm writing a procedure. Isomorphic. that's one. What that means, I have a bunch of loops like this. For I equals I, A to H, for J equals A to H, for K equals A to H. Then I would let 1 correspond to I, 2 correspond to J, 3 correspond to K. So I've got all these four loops buried in four loops. And then, over here, I can say 1 is connected to 2 and 4. And whatever I value I had here, I check to see if I is connected to whatever 2 and 4 are connected.
Okay.
So that's the idea. So I've got a, I'm trying to write a procedure whose input is two graphs, and I'm just going to try every possible way of associating the two sets of vertices. So imagine that you've decided that the right way to model your problem is with a graph. And now you want to actually start writing algorithms for it. So you want to find the cheapest way to get from Oakland to LAX. So one thing you call, how we're modeling graphs by pictures. So you could write a program to do some sort of image recognition to see what the picture is. Or you could come up with a better data structure to represent a graph. So what we're going to do, let's talk about three different types of data structures to represent graphs. So just to give you a layout, I'm going to show you three different ways to represent a graph. Adjacency matrix and by those weird coincidences that keep happening in this class, is we just talked about matrices a little bit earlier today, and then we end up having to meet. How does that keep, have you ever noticed how many times that's happened? It's like we've talked about something and it's come up 20 minutes later. It's crazy.
Deja vu means a glitch in the matrix.
Yeah. Thank you, right? I think that's a glitch. There's no way this should keep happening.
It's like how, you know, every problem in a math book always somehow turns out to a whole number.
Yeah.
It's like crazy, you know?
Yeah, yeah, what are the odds of that?
Very low.
So for all of the nice and zero.
Huh?
So probably exactly zero.
Yeah.
Ah, cool.
Mm-hmm. What, that every problem you'll ever approach comes out to a whole number?
So it's in, when you're doing infinitely many things, you can have something with probability zero that could happen. Python programmer, this is going to be a dictionary. Most other languages, this is going to be a map. Is the keys are going to be the vertices, and the values are going to be lists of vertices. What's A connected to?
These.
to represent, you can represent this different ways. So if you want it to be an array.
Is this something about keys or?
Yeah, so yeah, so this is a map. These are the keys, those are the values. So the keys are the vertices, the values are this. And I could ask you questions like, how would you compute the degree of a vertex? So, however, if this was the representation for this matrix, how do I compute the degree of the
vertex?
It's the length of this list. It's how many things are in that list. And then a couple of things. I'm going to mention this as I go along. You don't need to write it down. I'm not going to test you on it because this is just an intro class. Is could you use an adjacency list for a direct graph? So if A connected to E, but E didn't connect back to A. So if the arrow went like this, I would have AE, but I wouldn't put in the EA. So we can get the complete information about a directed graph by putting things in and leaving things out here. What about a weighted graph? So let's say, this is a distance, and A to E is 20.
How can you still get 20 back?
You're going to just write A to E, they write 20, and then that's probably.
Yeah, that's what I would do, is I would make these pairs. And so I would write this as E, 20. And maybe this would be C, 50, D, 80, E. And so instead of just listing the vertices, you've got an ordered pair, where the first element is the vertex, the second element is the weight. What was the second data structure? And remember, a matrix is just a rectangular grid of numbers. So what we do is we index the rows and we index the columns by the vertices. An adjacency matrix is going to be a 0-1 matrix. Let's start from the back. Is A connected to E? And go back to the original. It's undirected and unweighted. So is A connected to E? I'm going to put a 1 there. Is A connected to D? That's going to be a 0. A to C? A to B? E to A?
E to A.
And so we have to be careful, is I want that to be a no. If I did want A to be connected to A, I would have put a loop in like that.
So it's C.
So on this one, I don't have a loop, so maybe A is not connected. And the fact that this is an undirected graph means that if A is connected to E, then E is connected. So the row for A is going to be the same as the column for A. So B's row, is B connected to B?
No.
Right, remember we got those loops that have an edge. Is B connected to C?
Yes.
B to D?
Yes.
B to E? So B's row is 0, 0, 1, 1, 1.
Just a couple.
So B's column is 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. Very good. That's good. I'll just go ahead and fill this in. C to C, to C, to C, to E, to D, C to E, no. D to E. as a row, I wrote it down as a column and wrote it down as a row, if I built the transpose, you see I get the same thing I had here? So, that property, so with every undirected graph, when I do the transpose of the matrix, I'm going to get the matrix itself. And matrices with that property, in linear algebra, we had a name for those. Remember what that was? So the transpose is the operation of flipping it. And when the transpose was equal to itself?
Inverse.
Symmetric. Not inverse, symmetric. There's various things that you can say about symmetric matrices. I'm going to go off on a tangent talking about weighted and directed, and then we go back to a little bit more linear algebra. So could you modify an adjacency matrix for a weighted graph?
Yeah.
What I'd do if the A to E was 60 is I would just put a 60 here. And you have to be careful, is you better make sure that none of you, that all your weights are positive. You don't have a weight of 0. If you did, you have to figure out something else. If this was a directed graph, is there a way to modify it? Very good, yeah, it's not going to be symmetric. So what you do is, we're going to do this a little bit later in the class, is think about these matrices as the sources and those as the sinks. So if I had, don't write this down, I'm not going to test you on it. I want you to think about it. If I had A going to E, but not backwards, I would have a 1 here for A from A to E. But this would be a 0 because I don't have an edge from E to A. You could modify that. Now I'll go back to my original. So we're going to call this matrix A. You don't need to write this down either. I just want to show you the power of linear algebra. So if you worked out A squared here, it's this entry is a 2. What that represents is if I want to go from A to C with a 2-hop step, so in other words, I want to go from A to C with exactly one layover, E to C, exactly. So as I was saying, if I wanted to go from E to C, the two-hop step, one layover. That's what the 2 represents, is there's 2 ways to do it.
So it means 2 hops.
So this 2 means 2 hops, and this 2 means there's 2 hop turns.
Okay.
If I do the Boolean, I end up with a 1 here. What does that 1 represent?
There is
a 2-hop step from A to C. So let's imagine that I do A or A squared B A cubed. I just did this forever. Basically, is this one? A to C mean?
Okay, it's very possible.
It means that either there's a one hop path from A to C, or a two hop path, or a three hop path.
There's an N hop.
So this, in fact, there's a one here, says there is a way to get from A to C in the graph. So again, it's, we can do the operations we did here to talk about things, to talk about properties of the graph. What am I going to do now?
Incidence.
The incidence of matrix. So now, is any consolation? I think test 3 is the easiest of the bunch. The rows are going to be indexed by the vertices. And this time the columns are going to be indexed by the edges. And we're going to follow the math tradition of giving the best possible names to things. Represents the name of a point here. And to see why that's the perfect name for that point, do you know what it means? Go over one. So the name I'm going to give to this edge is, I'm going to call it AE, that's where that is. So I could give a name, I could call it Smiley or Superstar, or I could call it 1, but I think this is the best possible name. Are addressed by the columns are addressed by the edges. So A, B,
why you started with one letter versus the other?
Yes. Okay, actually, no, we haven't talked about this yet. Yes. So it's, I'm glad you brought that up. So as we go through these graphs, there's going to be lots of choices to make. And just to make my life easier when I'm grading, or because it's good to have a standard, is whenever you make a choice, I want you to use alphabetical or numeric. So if I want to call this AE or EA, which letter should I start with?
A.
Yeah, I'm really glad you brought that up. So it would not be wrong to do it the other way. You want to have standards. So the AE edge. What's the last column?
Yeah.
So this edge connects what two vertices? Connects A and E. So ones for those, zeros for the other ones. So I think this is how it works. Imagine that these are lists of suspected terrorists, and the edges represent there was some cell phone communication between two of them. And what you want to do is try to cluster the terrorists together into cells and see who's working with who. So if you take, this is kind of crazy, you take this matrix, and then you take the second smallest eigenvalue, you can exploit that, you can use that eigenvector to cluster these people up into different terrorist cells. Some cool linear algebra that you can use for this. Can we do this for a weighted graph? Can you modify it? Yeah, you could just write the weight. What about a directed graph? Actually, what we do is we use a 1 and a negative 1. So for AE, if it went from A to E, this ends up being a negative 1. And then the null space of that matrix, oh, so if this represents a circuit, the null space of that matrix tells you something about what you mean with the circuit, and then various, so the fundamental theorem of linear algebra just ends up being a pair of dot spots.
So
given a matrix, you can find its null space. And then it turns out that this is going to be in the null space of that matrix. And that tells you something if you're doing a circuit analysis, represents a circuit, then you're doing a circuit analysis.
Sorry, if it was weighted, you just change that A to that 60?
I would use.
Oh.
Like that. Or maybe I'd split up in 30. Circuits came first.
And they modeled the theorems after the patterns they saw in the circuit.
Oh, yeah, so I guess, yeah, here's what happened is so circuits were developed, and Ohm and Kirchhoff and those people worked out the laws. And then later, linear algebra gets developed, and people proved cool things about matrices. And then somebody said, hey, you know what? We could represent a circuit as a graph as a matrix. And then all those cool linear algebra theorems would actually have the analogs for that circuit. Whoa, look at the time. So I've got 1 minute. Yeah, I apologize. I've got some puzzles for you and the beginning of Wednesday.